please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Hello and welcome to our special series, The London Eye. My guest today is another emerging markets veteran, Edward Evans, Portfolio Manager and Chief Investment Officer of Ashmore Investment Management. He runs $5 billion in emerging markets, out of which $1 billion is in India. Edward, thank you very much for joining in today for the series. I want to ask you first how things are with the perception about emerging markets, particularly after the recent bout of strength in the dollar and the bout of volatility that we've got seen in 2018. Have people been ruffled or are they taking it in their stride?
No, that's it's a good starting point. I think emerging markets have suffered from a prolonged period of negative sentiment, which plateaued in 2016 and started to recover in 2017, and that's really continued year to date in 2018, and that's reflected by fund flow. So industry level fund flow data has continued to be sort of net positive. You're right, in the very recent term, you've had quite a few bouts of elevated volatility, stemming all from developed markets, which has caused volatility to pick up. But I think emerging markets and flow data has continued to point to investors picking off opportunities to increase their exposure.
There's no rush to redeem or anything like that, to take some of the profits of the last couple of years, or are people using these corrections to actually deploy more for cash?
I mean, it's difficult to get too much color of the industry data, but if I think anecdotally on the desk, institutional investors are very cognizant of the fact that emerging markets have been, under-owned over the past couple of years, and there's been a lot of a general structural change in investor views towards emerging markets, so they're adding more money to take advantage over the short-term volatility. Let's call them retail intermediary investors, do tend to be more, you know, sort of quick in their response to periods of market volatility. And if you look at passive data, passive fund flow data, then that does point to a more volatile series of flows.
So you've got nearly $5 billion in emerging market equities, and a billion of that is in India. But we are not getting, I mean, the anecdotal evidence is that foreign flows into India are not anything much to cheer about. Why do you think that is the case? I mean, are there local factors specific to India which is clouding the picture?
In the very recent term, India's been impacted by global challenges. Let's put that down as sort of concerns over the sustainability of global liquidity in US dollars, which has sort of very much piqued investor concerns, and that has impacted India because India has a current account deficit of around about 2%, and of course higher energy prices are putting pressure on your current account deficit. So there's quite a focus by the market looking for areas of vulnerability. Of course, locally, at a more domestic level in India as well, there's been some challenges, and these very structurally long-term positive reform measures are taking time to have their positive implications, ramifications. So I think over the very near term, India has been seen the brunt of sort of volatility of flows. Let's not forget the Indian stock market was up, 38-odd% last year, at least the MSCI India index in dollars. So I think some investors may have taken some profits while they then look to readjust their positioning.
Would the rupee be an additional worry factor for a lot of global investors like you?
I think the rupee's seen pressure given my comments around the current account deficit and so forth. It's at the minute there's a focus globally on currency pressure, and this start is very important to take a few steps back and think of it as it's starting, I think, with investors generally taking profits of a euro versus dollar after the strong move in the euro against the dollar, and that sort of morphed into taking profits in also emerging market currencies which have performed well, but also picking out certain countries, and Turkey and Argentina are the obvious two, which are more sensitive, more vulnerable to a reduction in global liquidity.
Where does crude oil come into the picture? Because that's another issue which hurts the perception of India, sentiment towards India. But how does a fund manager for emerging markets take the rupee into, take the price of crude oil into its portfolio strategy?
Yeah. We're not an energy specialist, and unless you're a commodity specialist firm, one tends to avoid putting a price on a barrel of oil. You can sort of think in more range bounds, but you don't base an investment decision on what the price of a barrel of oil will be tomorrow. If I think of our sort of stock holdings and our focus in India, it's far more on structural changes. It's far more on the beneficiaries of some of these reform measures that have been slowly but surely carried out over the last several years. So the banking sector is an obvious beneficiary of a lot of the changes that have happened. So the focus then is on those more certain areas where we have increased visibility than something like an energy price.
You alluded to this whole business of shrinking liquidity in the world per se. Obviously also for emerging markets. Mm-hmm. How do you see EM equities perform in a scenario like this, where overall we know that balance sheets are shrinking by the central banks?
Yes. We're in an episode where developed markets are trying to carefully unwind exceptional monetary policies put in place essentially post the financial crisis. And that is not an easy task. And you're likely to see it as a source of volatility as we continue. For emerging markets themselves, though, they actually benefited from their currencies weakening, becoming a lot more competitive post, for example, the 2013 pressure on currencies. That's enabled emerging market countries generally to run far tighter, stronger balance accounts, balanced economies. So the pressure of a reduction or a deceleration in abundant global liquidity is far less of a stress today than it was, for example, back in 2013 when the notorious taper tantrum happened. Now, of course, that's a generalized statement. There are exceptions to every rule, but generally emerging markets look far more credibly based in that sort of circumstance.
Would you go as far as to say that maybe it's a cycle of 5-6 years that we may have entered about a couple of years back in emerging markets? Or you think it's still stop-start, a couple of good years, one bad year? We still can't call it a proper cycle?
I think emerging markets have started a stronger cycle. And I think if you want to pinpoint the period it was in, sort of 2016, ultimately earnings are your sustainable driver of emerging market returns, and earnings reflect, if you like, where you are in a cycle. And of course, after a prolonged period of negative earnings expectations, it plateaued in 2016. It recovered strongly last year in 2017, which incidentally meant that the strong stock market move you had was very well supported. And it's continued in 2018. And I think the key focus for a fundamental manager such as myself is following the earnings progression. So earnings expectations are higher, so it's more challenging to beat those from a simple mathematical higher base effect. But so far, at least in local currency terms, you are seeing those higher expectations being met. Earnings are also notably strong, broad-based across countries and also industry groups. So it points to an overall quite a constructive view on emerging markets.
But on earnings, are you happy with what's come out of India? Because there seems to be an air of disenchantment if you look at aggregate earnings. In 2017, India did not quite deliver as much as some of its other EM counterparts.
Yes. Expectations for earnings in India in 2018 are the highest it's been for several years. And what's driven that is expectations in the banking sector. I think it's fair. There is, investors want to see the structural changes implemented in India having a positive ramifications, so expectations are strong. Mm. And I think one will need to be selective within, as you would in any country, within those earnings expectations.
How do you read the banking sector in India? Because the corporate banks still seem to be struggling. There's a lot of news flow about scams coming out of the public or the state-owned banks. Where do you stand with Indian banks relative to other EM financials?
India's got some very high quality, more private orientated banks, which continue to grow from strength to strength and take advantage of many of the positive hallmarks of a growing emerging market country with great demographics. The public side clearly has, let's say, is going through a period of change. The bank recapitalization is certainly helping, but still, again, one needs to be selective within that. I think overall, one could point to the banking sector in India as having stabilized its pool of poor loans. I think as the economy is recovering, which it is, that will also make the NPLs and non-performing loans a less important part of the focus of the market as economic growth is recovering. And of course, things like the bankruptcy protocol process, which is currently being worked through, that is also, I think, a net positive. So overall, it's quite a constructive view, but one needs to be wary that it will take time for these positives to really come out, and one needs to be selective between the banks.
How much of it is in the price now? Because we've had a couple of years of reasonably good performance in emerging markets, including India. Mm-hmm. What is the price capturing now, Bob? Do you think it's ahead of earnings growth, or do you think there is still some room for prices to expand as earnings kick in?
Yes. One of the challenges as a emerging market investor in India is the valuation, because of the potential for India to perform, because of the potential for India to really fulfill its promise. As a poster child for emerging markets, you tend to have to pay up a high valuation, a whole high multiple for that. At the minute, the MSCI Emerging Market Index is on just below 12 times next year's earnings. India's on somewhere between 17 and 18 times next year's earnings. But the earnings, like I said, have improved. So they're over, expectations are for over 20% this year. So on that basis, valuations are supported. And indeed, valuations versus history look better. But again, it's not one size fits all. So we spend a lot of time really sort of getting to know businesses extremely well, the challenges they face, and how quickly they benefit from these changes that are happening in India.
What's the biggest risk to your emerging market thesis right now? That things are constructive, you're in a five-year good space with the EMs. What do you worry most about?
Developed world. Developed markets. I'm afraid it's problems in developed markets causing volatility in emerging markets. I mean, year to date, you've really had all the tail risks in a way coming to the fore, right? So you've had the sort of increased protectionism around trade and the potential ramifications around that. Our base case, at least, is actually the chances of that, or the probability of that escalating to a global trade war, if you will, actually seems pretty low likelihood. The world's become very complex. Global supply chains are very much integrated, so it's very difficult to pinpoint and cherry pick off tariffs across industries. Instead, I think if you think of US's main trade partners, it comes down to your Mexico, Canada, China, of course, Japan and Germany. And if you look through that list, then the NAFTA negotiations are clearly progressing, which I think in a way point to a pragmatic approach from the US authorities. Japan is a key ally in Asia for China, for the US, and somewhere like Germany clearly has the support of the EU. So that really leaves China as the standalone. So it becomes a more of a bilateral trade negotiation between the two. Now that hasn't gone away, and I expect that volatility to keep coming back. But you know, overall, you're sort of ascribing a low probability to an escalation in a trade tariff war. I think it would be very pinpointed between those countries. I can't help but think in the US's case, they've perhaps got more than half an eye on the forthcoming midterm elections and positive newsreel ahead of that. And there's sufficient pragmatic steps in place to prevent any escalation.
Is that the only issue relating to the developed world that worries you? Or do you worry about the bond yield inflation scenario, which a lot of people seem to be quite worried about in the US?
Yes, yeah. The focus from the Federal Reserve on tightening, and indeed the Eurozone, which will increasingly is starting this step, this sort of policy normalization, if you want to call that, is to my mind very much focused on improving the toolbox for future use. Okay, Developed markets put in place exceptional monetary policy since the financial crisis, and they're unwinding that as carefully as they can without forming discolation to economies or discolation to stock markets. I think in the US's case, they're communicating very loudly and clearly their path of normalization. And of course, markets will sometimes be slightly ahead and slightly behind, so you have adjustment periods. But without there being significant inflationary pressure coming through, then this is in turn pointing to actually quite a benign global growth environment from the US. And if the US is growing nicely, if the Eurozone is growing nicely as it is, then all around that points to a favorable context for emerging market companies to operate in.
If all this is true, why do you get the sense that investors appear more skittish this year? I mean, you know, small things spark off large bouts of volatility compared to last year where, you know, you would get a 2% correction and markets would come back to new highs very easily. Mm-hmm. This year, there seems to be an edge of nervousness. Why would you say that is palpable?
I think that's probably driven by technicals to some extent. So investors repositioned themselves last year. They benefited, as we see with hindsight, from a very strong period of returns and low volatility. Mm-hmm. And now there's a situation where investors take profits, readjust their portfolios as they see fit to reflect the fundamentals. I think emerging markets have been pushed to and fro by this, but I think that's an opportunity for investors to pick up exposure within emerging markets at quite healthy valuations.
That's what you're doing, buying any significant dip that you're getting?
Not any dip, but we're certainly taking advantage of the periods of volatility, yes.
I want to ask you about politics in India a bit, because we are heading towards an important election. We're already going through many state elections. Mm-hmm. As an investor, a significant investor, how important is that, you think?
I think elections and let's call it politics or political noise in India is only going to get more important, and I think it's going to be a source of volatility in India as we head towards them in 2019. Taking a few steps back, the policies themselves inherently seem to be actually not that divisive across the political spectrum in India. So whilst this could be a source of volatility, the actual impact on, let's say, fundamentals, which ultimately drive stock prices over the long run, seem perhaps less important. But it is clearly something that the market's going to watch increasingly closely. As you have a series of local elections between now and then, the results, the reaction from Modi's government will clearly be a point of focus by the market.
Coming back to the earnings cycle in emerging markets, how confident are you that we'll get a full-fledged CapEx cycle as well once corporates start seeing earnings flow in? Mm-hmm. Because that's really the sweet spot where investments also kick in and you get a much more prolonged and a sweet cycle. Are you getting the sense that that kind of confidence has returned, or you don't get, I mean, are investors more optimistic than the companies themselves?
Mm-hmm. No, I think that's a good question. I think from a company perspective, there are signs of that coming through, but let's not forget we're still, I think, almost in an earlier phase. We're still in a sort of a recovery, a stabilization phase after multiple years of negative expectations and, quite frankly, quite poor corporate discipline. Emerging markets had it pretty easy prior to the financial crisis. I think it's taken them longer than you'd hope as an investor to acclimatize to this new low growth, low global growth for longer backdrop, and hence, there's been a focus by corporates on managing tighter ships, greater, cost discipline, capital allocation discipline, which we've very much seen sort of coming through last year and continuing this year. I think the next step, to your point, is the corporates starting to invest more proactively, which I'm confident of.
So where are we in the earnings cycle now? Because that's the big one. Last couple of years we've got some earnings growth, but not quite the 20% plus earnings growth, which leads to big P multiple expansions. Do you think it's a matter of time before that will happen, or is this going to be a slightly more anemic kind of an earnings growth cycle?
Well, taking the MSCI Emerging Market Index, earnings growth was around the mid-20s last year. And of course, you had the stock market up almost 30%, so it essentially supported that earnings trajectory as we went through the year. So it meant at the beginning of 2017, you're asked to pay 12 times next year's earnings. At the end of 2017, you're asked to pay 12 times next year earnings. So from a valuation perspective, it was an exceptional period. It remained very benign. Moving into 2018, the year started very strongly. Valuations got pushed up. It was becoming, I think, more stretched. There were signs. But then you've seen earnings come through and expectations sort of stabilize. Mm. And in local currency terms, these expectations are continuing to be met and in many cases beaten. So it is really a case of following the money to give you that sort of reassurance that that outlook in emerging markets will continue.
A question about geopolitics. Do you think things are slowly on the mend, or do you, this recent salvo between that US has fired on Iran destabilizes matters once again?
It's never straightforward. As quickly as one thinks that the geopolitics are improving, the dynamics change again. There's nobody has any greater insight on those areas, so it's not, you don't base investment decisions on geopolitics. Of course, you're wary about how the changes could have ramifications, but it's not something you can make a fundamental based decision on.
So if you were running a large GEM portfolio today, what would be your top four overweights and top three underweights, country-wise?
Country-wise, global emerging markets, yeah. Well, if I look at our portfolio, areas that we favour the most, we don't allocate by country. It's rather looking top down at country and then through country at industry groups in countries. So the areas we favour a lot, for example, are the semiconductor space, which points to an overweight in South Korea and Taiwan, which has been performing very, very well. We are underweight India as a whole on aggregate, but we have a good exposure in a well-run private bank, and indeed have added to a public bank earlier this year. So it is a play. India is a country that we'd look to opportunistically take advantage of volatility to add exposure to, albeit selectively.
Are you still hopeful that despite the volatility of the first half of the year, we could actually eke out some gains by the time the year is out for EM equities?
For emerging market equities, yes, I think so. I mean, I think it's interesting that, I mean, despite, quite frankly, all the tail risk coming to the fore seemingly this, you know, year-to-date period, emerging markets are essentially flat over the period. Net flows at the industry level have continued generally to tick in. Earnings growth expectations remain strong and very broad-based by country and industry group, and those expectations are being met. So I think, in a way, the biggest risk out there is that investors get blindsided by the global tail risks and miss following the fundamentals of emerging.